And we're back for what could be the finale. So I have an idea. So no matter what, we're going to have to tank an enemy phase. So I'm going to move Balthus here. Actually, I'd never explored your combat arts. No, you still die. And your gambit won't do anything. So yeah, I'm just going to healing focus you, right? Byleth is going to come down here and do this. But can he do it? No, he can't. No, I think Thunderbrand's his best play. So we're gonna do this. Crit! No, damn it. Oh? Wait. Why didn't Ray attack? Okay. Final health bar. So now the question is, will Happy survive? According to this, no. So I got two ideas.
More fighting.
The first one we're gonna try here is dance for Byleth. Just try to cause as much chaos as possible. Byleth can kill her here, I think. Let me get a calculator. 19 times 3 is 57. Byleth would have to get 4 straight crits to kill. But we're just gonna try it. There's one. Okay. Okay. Nice dodge. One more. Damn it. Okay. 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 We do that. Ooh. So I think now we can move Bernie in and Gambit. Maybe we can deter Rhea from Happy.
I got it.
We almost have a full shield break.
Onward.
This hits everyone, right? Yep. Oh, Bernie can pull it off with a dodge. Let's try it. If Bernie dodges, we win. If Bernie dodges or survives, we win. Charged attack. She died. Happy died.
Was there any more?
Okay. That was option one. Here is option two, that I think was the better play.
What's my strategy?
So Byleth is gonna come down and do this. He's gonna gambit.
Need a hand? Now's our chance.
Okay. So now he wants Byleth. Or she wants Byleth, pardon me. And I'm not going to break her shield here. And then Dorothea comes here and dances for Happy.
Why not?
And Happy clears. Clears out. Right? Just leaves. Go home, go bed. And Flayne will come down and fortify.
I do this for all of us.
Actually, maybe I do want to kill. Nope, that's not worth it. Now we're just gonna wait.
I'm your girl.
I'm just gonna try Annette's Gambit one more time. Because Annette, I know, can survive a Horrorfrost. Nope. Okay, guys. They all dodged! Oh my. Oh, please. Okay, Bernie hits a gambit. Oh my gosh, guys, this could be it. Yes. There's the broken shield. Okay, Annette can do this. This is safe. No miracle. Okay, final health bar. Holy shit. Byleth whips out his Thunderbrand and does this. Dodges. Byleth, we needed a crit. He's gonna clear.
Ready for anything.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Hilda needs to move. Fuck it. Every little bit helps. Nice. Perfect. Hilda, that was huge. Okay, then now Ferdinand actually can just come here. Oh my gosh, please. 82 health. Nice dodge. Lance of Ruin breaks, I don't care. It did its job. Let's just see if Balthus can survive this. Yes. Yes. No! Damn it. Balthus, we would have. Okay, okay. Just dance.
Well done. What's my strategy?
Can anybody hit a last minute gambit? Kaspar. Let's try it.
This better work.
Nope. Byleth. We need one crit.
Oh, yeah.
Byleth, we need one crit. Yes! Yes! Oh my gosh! Yes! It's over! Oh! We did it!
Oh, it's over! Oh my gosh! In 60 turns, and that is Silver Snow maddening. Oh.
Rhea, please.
You are here, Mother.
Wow. So we're going to save over this. Yeah, I didn't even have to use the final three free times to grind. What a group. Let's just save over this. 82 hours.
A rising flame was alight as the flow of time carved a new history for Fodlan. Rhea's wild rampage was put to an end, averting what could have been the greatest crisis in the history of Fodlan. After 5.5 years of war, a new age was set to begin. The Empire, Kingdom, and Alliance, all political structures that had once shaped the continent, were gone. A unified nation began to take shape under the watchful eye of the Church of Saros. The Church's new leader became a champion of the people, working tirelessly to help them overcome the horrors of war and to carve out a path towards reconstruction. Just as Saint Saros tended to those who suffered in wars of the past, Fodlan's new ruler embraced their role as mother of all life and arbiter of every soul.
Now we get to find out who we S-ranked. Yeah, and that's my wife, not Dr. Fapples.
Professor, I...
Actually, and I don't think I... No, I haven't S-ranked Lysithia before, so this is new for me also. We've done what we can.
We have. I can feel that the crests are no longer a part of me. That must mean my body will.
Can't say for sure, but we can hope.
Thank you, Professor. No matter the outcome, I feel a sense of peace. I have hope, and that hope will carry me through it all. You've done so much, searching for a way to remove my crest, to save me. I can't tell you how much it means to me.
So what will you do now?
I will not claim my title. House Ordelia will end with my father's generation. After this, I'm going to begin preparations for our family's dissolution. This will ensure that the people of our territory will not be troubled, and my parents will be able to live out their lives in peace.
And after that?
A good question. I hadn't considered it, but assuming I have life left in me, would it be all right if I came back here to stay by your side? Without my crests, I'm not sure what all I'd be able to do for you. But you have given me a new life. I want to use my time to support you however I can. I just...
Cynthia, I want you to have this.
Oh, is this... This is...
I'll be waiting for your safe return.
What I said earlier about not caring what the outcome of all this is, I take it back. For the longest time, I didn't think I'd be around to be a part of the future you and everyone were creating, that I had no place in it. But now, I cannot fight it any longer. I do care, and I do not wish to give up on chasing that future. I do not wish to die. I refuse to give up on myself or on our future. And so, I promise to come back to you, no matter what. Once I'm back...
We'll chase that future together.
Yes, I quite like the sound of that. Together, it is decided. We will be together forever, living long, full lives. Count on it, my love.
It's over! I have conquered Silver Snow Maddening. Oh, wow, what a playthrough, wow. 78 turns on Rivalry of the Houses. Alright, thank you to everybody who tuned in for this. After the credits are done rolling, I'm gonna give my final thoughts on all of the units. And yeah. So, those of you who are new to the channel, Silver Snow, this playthrough, was actually voted on by you guys in a video poll that I did a while back. It was between Silver Snow, Ocarina of Time, and Persona 4 Golden. And Silver Snow won by one vote over Ocarina. And so now I'm going to do another vote. So make sure you keep tabs on the community tab on the channel, which is where I'll be posting the next poll. I didn't do the previous vote in the community section because I didn't have it at the time. YouTube hadn't given it to me yet. So yeah, that's what I'm going to do. Look for the next poll there. I know what three games are going to be in, but I'm not going to say what they are yet because I want it to be a surprise. Actually, by the time this video is out, because this is going to come out on January 1st, I think. Oh, Happy New Year's, everyone. I think. No, this will be after New Year's. Either way, Happy New Year's, everyone. So yeah, I hope you all vote. I hope you all stay tuned for what's to come. And I'm at a loss for words. I didn't think that the final map would go this well. Most of the divine pulses that I had to use in that final map were just RNG. I played that very safe, which is really the only way you can play that map. And yeah, so let's... Yeah, I'm happy with how things went, so let's just read up on all this. Constance, Sorcery Incarnate. For her service in war and her innovations in magic, Constance von Nouvelle was among the first to receive peerage in the New Fodland. For generations thereafter, her noble house was valued as a leader in magical research and development. Anna, the traveling merchant. Anna's business savvy proved to be a great asset in the post-war reconstruction of Garagmach. Once the restoration was complete, she disappeared from the area entirely, though tales of a mysterious merchant were passed down in every corner of the world for centuries to come. Some say she continues her travels even to this day, eternally peddling her wares, and ever in search of the next lucrative opportunity. Limitless potential, Cyril. My ass, your growth rates suck. Even with aptitude, they're bad. Unable to serve Rhea any longer, Cyril nearly left the church. He was persuaded to stay, however, to assist in rebuilding the monastery he had helped maintain. Thanks to his devoted work ethic, the Officer's Academy was able to reopen a few years later. When the new students took to the reception hall, Cyril found himself among them. Distant Archer Shamir. Shortly after the war, Shamir gave up the mercenary life and disappeared. Though she was never heard from again, rumors swirled persistently for years of a master archer turned thief who lined her pockets by shaking down all those who preyed upon the innocent. Free Knight Catherine. Catherine left the Knights of Saris and set out to travel across Fodlan. With Thunderbrand in hand, she took it back. She wandered the countryside, seeking always to defend the innocent and punish the wicked. Her many years of heroics ensured that she would always be remembered by the people as a beloved folk hero. Son of the Knights, Alois. Once all the fighting had come to an end, Alois officially took up the position of Captain of the Knights of Saris. In this capacity, he was much beloved, and the Knights became more unified than ever under his command. It is said that their accomplishments during his tenure, were beyond even what Geralt's troop had achieved. Divine Songstress Manuela. Manuela left Garrigmach to build her own academy in a small, war-torn town. There, she contributed heavily to rebuilding efforts while teaching future generations the necessary skills of survival. Though she never married or had children of her own, she spent the last years of her life happily devoted to her students. It's a shame the game devs couldn't give her a happy ending, like saying, oh, and she married, she finally found love. Father of Crestology and the man himself, Hanuman. Though Fodlan had changed, Hanuman's goal remained unwavering. To determine the workings of Crest and to do away with inequality caused by them. To that end, his research resulted in magical tools that could be used even without the aid of Crest. This proved to be yet another worthwhile discovery by the Father of Crestology. The Blade Breaker 2, Leone. Leone joined up with the mercenaries formerly led by Geralt. As his greatest apprentice, she quickly took on a leadership role and eventually even inherited the title of Blade Breaker. She came to be known as Geralt II as she began to resemble him in all things, including his drinking habits. She left behind many unpaid tavern tabs. That's probably the cringiest ending ever. Like, really? Can her character not move past Geralt? Survivor of the Curse, Marianne. Marianne returned home to a hero's welcome. The people praised her talent and acknowledged her as a savior of Fodlan. Her adoptive father groomed her as his successor, teaching her the power of words over weapons. By the time she claimed her inheritance, she had transformed into one of Fodlan's most skilled orators. Worldly Artist Ignatz. After returning home, Ignatz persuaded his family that he should become a painter. He traveled all through Fodlan and beyond, painting beautiful landscapes and captivating portraits of the world's cultures. His unique style set the artistic paradigm for a generation. Noble of the Red Rose, Lorenz. Soon after the war, Lorenz assumed leadership over House Gloucester and helped govern Fodlan as a representative of the old Alliance lords. His political talent yielded revolutionary policy changes, many of which were of particular benefit to the common folk. Stalwart Knight Ingrid. When Galatea territory was seized, Ingrid argued strongly for the preservation of its borders. Her request was granted, and she was appointed to rule. From her new position, she gave her all to ensure that the people of Galatea lived peaceful lives and put in years of hard work to reform its farming practices. Her efforts bore fruit to the people's delight, and Galatea became a land of plenty. Ash, the Arrow of Justice. After the war, Ash was formally knighted and appointed the new head of House Gaspard, which had no successors. His warm, sincere attitude toward his subjects was praised all over Fodlan, and Ash was finally recognized as the ideal knight he'd always hoped to be. His deeds live on in countless tales. Benevolent Soul Mercedes, who I should have trained, she saw one battle. Mercedes left home and went to Garrigmach, where she became a model cleric. She devoted her whole life to the service of the goddess and became well-loved by the people, who revered her for her piety and her boundless generosity toward those in need. Yuri, 3 battles, 1 kill. After Fodlan had healed from the war, Yuri's organization spent the next few decades cultivating and controlling illicit markets. Not coincidentally, Wherever Yuri's underground businesses thrived, so too did orphanages and almshouses. For the awe and respect his generosity earned him among the downtrodden, Yuri came to be known as the Underground Lord. Sincerest of Knights, Sylvain. 5 battles, 2 kills. As Margrave Gautier, Sylvain devoted his life to improving relations with the people of the Strang region. With oration alone, he succeeded in helping to create a new way of life for nobles in which relics and crests were no longer viewed as necessary. Though he went down in history as an extraordinary lord, it nevertheless became customary to refer to cheaters as Sons of Gautier. Meandering Sword Felix, 6 battles, 2 kills. Even after the war's end, skirmishes continued to break out across Fodlan. Bored and restless in his capacity as Duke for Aldarius, Felix abandoned his title, jumping at the opportunity to wield the sword again. Little is known of his whereabouts thereafter, but even many years later, soldiers continued to whisper rumors of a mysterious man able to deal swift death to scores of enemies. Slumbering Princess Flame, 20 battles, 18 kills. Flame disappeared soon after the war, and over time it was all but forgotten that she had ever existed. Many long years later, however, a young woman resurfaced in a completely transformed Fodlan. When she looked to the man who stood beside her, she wondered if it would be alright in this new era to call him father. She went to sleep again. Heir of Purpose, Seta, 28 battles, 19 kills. I tried to train Seteth, but it just didn't work. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to read everybody's ending, and I'm going to give my review of them now, because now we're starting to get into the units that were being used. Anyway, Seteth remained at the monastery and worked to restore the authority of the Church of Saros. Doing away with his old strictness, he adopted a tolerant stance towards all. His encouragement of believers to respect those of other faiths helped the people of Fodlan to find common ground with others. Hilda and Raphael. Hilda, 60 battles, 33 kills. Raphael returned to his hometown, where he served as liege lord as a knight for a time. Later, he gave it up to help manage the inn that his family had opened up during his time away. One day, to the great joy of Raphael's sister, Maya, Hilda came to visit. Maya had always treasured the necklace Hilda had made for her. Moved by this, Hilda gave Maya a new gift of a hairband, which inspired Maya to suggest that Raphael convert the inn into an accessory shop. Hilda decided to stay and help out, and eventually became the shop's proprietor and chief artisan. She moved in with Raphael, and the two spent their lives happily dealing in fashionable accessories. So Hilda is just an all-around really solid unit, and even with the late start, she was still able to be pretty useful. She wasn't very good for the final mass, but man, she could tank, and that's really what I needed out of her. Especially with Petra kind of falling off late game. Bloomed Overachiever Annette, and my wife. 399 battles, 203 kills. Annette returned to her hometown of Ferdiad, where she took up a teaching position at the Royal School of Sorcery. She was a gifted instructor, and many of her students went on to become world-renowned sages. Though her talent for teaching was remarkable in its own right, she was perhaps best remembered for effortlessly securing the trust and respect of her many students, as well as inspiring all who knew her by living a life of kindness, cheer, and humility. Linhart and Caspar. Linhart, 132 battles, 52 kills. Caspar, 370 battles, 166 victories. Oh yeah, Annette. Annette was hands down one of my best units this run. She was just the deleter of warriors and armored knights throughout the whole run. Like, I never run Maddening anymore without Wyvern Annette. She is just a staple in any run. So, eventually when I do my all-star run of three houses where I use only the best units in the best builds, which will be in Crimson Rose, which I hope you guys are looking forward to. I don't know when that'll be. But yeah, Annette will definitely be a starter in the all-star run. Anyway, Linhart, definitely the worst healer in the game. He isn't really a good mage tank. Maybe I just got a cursed Linhart, but he was a really solid healer with the healing stuff. Like, he could heal anyone to full from how low they were, which is pretty helpful. So he had that going for him, but not much really to say about that. Kind of lackluster and everything else. Caspar, I kind of had a good Caspar, I'm not going to lie. He didn't really damage a whole lot, but I fed him a bunch of defense buffers throughout the game. Well, not a bunch, but a handful. And he turned into a bit of a tank. So like Hilda, he just took on a tank role and never really developed much offense to him, which has always been a problem for Kaspar, no matter who you are. Yeah, very happy with these two, and I mainly got the job done. After the war, Linhart and Kaspar abandoned their noble houses to pursue a carefree journey wandering the world. They traveled to every corner of Fodland and even ventured abroad now and again. Kaspar got into trouble at every turn on their travels, but Linhart was always there, begrudgingly, to get him out of it. The records of their adventures were immobilized in a book by an anonymous author called The Thousand Roads and Seven Seas. It is said that they did eventually settle down after the events in those stories, but where they actually went is unknown. Dorothea and Petra. Petra returned to her homeland in Bridget and inherited the throne from her grandfather. As ruler, she declared independence from Fodland and renegotiated Bridget's diplomatic ties to that nation on more equal terms. At every step along the way, she was accompanied by Dorothea, who had left Fodland behind to support her. Dorothea used the connections she made in her time at the opera to her benefit, and even worked reluctantly with the Fodland nobility for Petra's sake. The people of Bridget were skeptical of her at first, but warmed up to her over time. It is said that she became the person whom Petra loved the most. So Dorothea was a solid dancer. Like, she danced, and she danced. She's a really lackluster mage, damage-wise. Like, I've never had an offensive Dorothea. But I don't know how to make Dorothea work as an offensive unit. I mean, maybe put her down a Swordmaster route late game to give her sword skill. But she would need a lot of res. I think it's based on res, not magic. Which kind of hinders her. But she had 214 battles and 64 kills. Petra had 447 battles and 192 kills. I had a solid Petra. I tried her out on a Wyvern Lord for the first time. Usually I just keep her down the sword path and then put her on a Falcon Knight late game or keep her as a Swordmaster. And she can become a pretty good dodge tank that way. But I should have committed Petra fully to the Wyvern Lord instead of going to Falcon Knight. That was a mistake, because as soon as I put Petra on a Falcon Knight, she fell off. She got strength screwed. After she started strength blessed. Like, I had a really hard hitting Petra for a while. But I put her on a Falcon Knight and she just fell off. I should have put her on a Wyvern Lord. But apart from that, Petra was really solid this run. Same for Dorothea. But again, anyone who's a dancer who has decent mobility can be really good in this run. Balthus and Happy. Balthus, 452 battles, 182 kills. Happy, 422 battles and 174 kills. Shortly after the war, Happy and Balthus disappeared. Their absence from the world stage was not lasting, however. As before long, they emerged as the leaders of an elite band of mercenaries. The group traveled all over Fodland helping those in need, with a noted specialty in handling monsters. It is said that these mercenaries lived raucously, I think, laughing often, and not a single sigh of discontent was ever heard. Some years later, when those who slithered in the dark returned to threaten Fodland once again, these mercenaries were instrumental in dealing with them. Balthus is Balthus and Happy, like Annette, have just become a staple in every single Maddening run that I've done since I tried them out in when was that? I think it was my first. Yeah, it was my first ever. I think Azure Moon run. I think I've said that before, but I tried them out just to try out the new DLC units. And they both became staples. I put Balthus on a crit build. I tried it just for the memes, and it turned out to be broken. And Happy is just instrumental with dealing with monsters and demonic beasts. Like, giving her a Thersis, she'll become just the ultimate monster killer. She might not be able to one-round them all, or whatever health bar they're on. But her being able to snipe Sailor from range and open up a broken shield for everybody else to pick on is insane. Especially in this mode when you have to deal with so many demonic beasts. Like, look forward for Happy and Balthus to also be starters on the All-Star run. Like, they are both just insane. I tried out a more defensive Balthus build. I didn't fully commit to his Wrath build. But he still worked out great. He wasn't as high critting as my last Balthus, but he was still solid. And that says a lot about how good of a unit he is. Ferdinand and Bernie. Ferdinand, 545 battles, 198 kills. Bernie, 527 battles, 172 kills. After the war, Bernadetta renounced her claim to House Varley. She married Ferdinand, the new Duke Eyre, and the two contributed to relief efforts by instituting reforms across their dukedom. Due to the success of those policies, Ferdinand was offered the opportunity to help govern all of Fodland. He accepted, leaving the management of Eyre territory to his wife. While he worked to apply their ideas to the world at large... Since Bernadetta did not like to leave home, Ferdinand's life involved a lot of travel, but it is said he always embarked on his return home with a smile. Aww. Yeah, I don't think I've seen that paired ending before. Again, just because I never use Ferdinand, because he's the most difficult unit to recruit. Ferdinand, hands down, probably... Ferdinand was definitely top three units in this run. I'd say Ferdinand top three with Dr. Fapple and probably Annette. I think those are my big three. Yeah, Ferdinand's definitely a starter on the All-Star squad. Like, I'm so glad I took him off of a Paladin. Normally, I've always run my Ferdinands on Paladin. But Paladins just hinder speed and they don't give good defense buffs. So Paladins for me have always just kind of fallen off late game. They don't really tank at all. But I committed Ferdinand to the flyer route. I gave him a blow sealed build. And it worked beautifully for him. Because I said in the pre-map for the final battle that I tested my normal build for Hilda, giving her two seal skills and two blow skills and putting her on a wyvern, and tried it on Ferdinand, and it worked just as well. Like, Ferdinand became my Hilda. Like, Hilda and Ferdinand are definitely on the same level as each other. So I've definitely figured out the ideal Wyvern Lord build, and I just proved it with Ferdinand. I don't have Hilda on it on film, but I've ran Hilda a lot. This is actually the first playthrough I've never run Hilda for most of the game, besides Crimson Rose and all that, but that's just because you can't. But, and now Bernie? I'm gonna give Bernie my J. Gobes Award for most improved unit. I have always run Bernie on a Bow Knight. This is the first time I have ever run Bernadette on anything but a Bow Knight, and I kept her as a sniper. Usually I've always put Bernie on a Bow Knight because I've always had strength screwed Bernies. Like, her strength growth isn't that impressive. So I put her on a Bow Knight just to be the unit baiter and help deal with flying units. But I realized early game that I had a strength blessed Bernadetta. And so I decided just to try her out as a sniper. And as soon as she got Hunter's Volley, it was over. She was the ultimate flyer killer, and she was instrumental in this final battle. She was huge. Like, and you can definitely tell how much action she saw. Like, 527 battles. Actually, I'm going to screenshot that for future reference. I'm going to compare that to my future Bernadettas. But, I mean, Bernie at the time was maybe an alternate or adjutant for the All-Star run, because I've been playing the All-Star run for a while now, as I've played through all four routes on Maddening mode. And I've kind of just experimented with builds to get a true sense of who would make that roster. Bernie was a light maybe in terms of being an adjutant. But now, seeing how well she performed as a sniper, she could very well find herself a starter for the sniper position. But she's going to be competing with Felix for that position, because I ran Felix as a sniper in my most recent Azure Moon run. And let me tell you, Felix is just insane as a sniper. So I'll probably just develop Bernie and Felix as snipers, and whoever just turns out better will get to start. The other will be the adjutant. But yeah, Bernie definitely wins the J. Gobes most improved unit of the run, because my impressions of her shot up this run. Like, I've definitely been playing Bernie wrong. She definitely should have never been a Bow Knight. She should have always been a sniper. And lastly, we have Dr. Fapple and Lysithia. The Wandering Flame Fapple and Scholar of Misfortune Lysithia. Lysithia had no battles. Dr. Fapple, 508 battles and 201 kills. Fapple announced his engagement to Lysithia shortly after becoming leader of the United Kingdom of Fodolin. Oh, that's what they called it. Before they were officially wed, she returned home to help her father to restore Ordelia territory and offered the land up to be governed directly by the new kingdom. Once the affairs of House Ordelia were in order, Lysithia finally married and became queen. Even without her crest, she proved more capable in the role, applying her great insight and intelligence toward a better Fodolin. When the rebuilding effort was complete, the couple and their children enjoyed long and peaceful lives. So, Dr. Fapple, not much I can say. Actually, there's something that I can say. I had a screwed Byleth early game. My Byleth was terrible early game, and he never really picked up. He had some good growth rates in the end, which kind of helped him catch back up. I'd say Byleth was on par. I wouldn't say he was behind in end game. But if I didn't give Fapple Thunderbrand, I don't know how much, like, better the Rhea fight would have gone. It would have been a lot worse if he didn't have Thunderbrand. And giving him a Yuri's relic, the one that gives him Kanto, is broken. Like, I broke him. Even with mediocre growths, I broke Fapple with that relic. I have never ran that relic before. I always just threw it in the combo because I didn't think it very good. But oh my gosh, that is insane to give Dr. Fapple Kanto without making him a flyer. Yeah, so that's definitely going to be making a return. And Lysithia, she's still the best mage in the game. What can I say? I never ran her just because I didn't have the chance and she was such a late recruit. I wanted to get her. If you watch the early episodes, I wanted Lysithia early. But she just wouldn't join, and as such, it just cost her. She just sat on the bench. But in the end, she still got to marry Dr. Fapple. Alright. I think that's everybody. Let's screenshot that. Alright. It's over, everybody. Once again, thank you all so much for tuning in. This was a long series. Actually, not really, compared to Splatoon and Persona. Like, this wasn't too terrible, but this was still a longer series. Again, I hope you all turned out and voted. But actually, by the time this comes out, the poll will probably be done because I got to get started on the next game, whatever you guys vote. But yeah, if you guys want to see more Fire Emblem, let me know. I love Fire Emblem. I would like to do maybe another Verdant Wind Maddening run before the All-Star run. Just because there's a couple new builds I want to try with some of the Golden Deer. I have the Blue Lions all dialed in. I know who the All-Stars are for there. I know what builds are best for them. Although I want to try Wyvern Dimitri. I've never put Dimitri on a Wyvern. I really want to try it. But once I get kind of an idea of the final builds for everybody, and then we'll do the All-Star run, where it's going to be a New Game Plus run on Crimson Rose. And we're just going to try to break the game. I'm doing New Game Plus so I can instantly recruit all of the units out of the get-go. So you're going to see, like, Wyvern Lord, Ferdinand, Wrath, Crit, Build, Balthus, Edelgard, Sniper, Felix, Wyvern Lord, Sylvain, Paladin, Leone, you know, the Wyvern Lord Hilda. Wait, no, she won't be able to participate, so she'll be an honorable mention. But that's beside the point. Point being, there's going to be an All-Star run coming soon for the Black Eagles. Or, I guess, just Fire Emblem 3 House, where I pick my best units, which is, I've said that already. But anyways, stay tuned for what's to come. I don't know at this time what the next series is going to be coming up after this in 2 days. But look forward to it. I hope to see you all there. Let me know your thoughts on this run. What builds do you like to do for your units? What are your thoughts on Silver Snow? Yeah, just let me know your thoughts. And stay tuned and stick around for the polls and other videos to come. I hope you guys all stick around. We got a nice little community here, so stay around, make yourself feel comfortable. We're all pretty friendly. You guys are really cool. I don't think I have anything else. Leave any game suggestions down below and let me know of also any other builds that you guys like to run in Three Houses. And yeah, that's all I've got. So, once again, thank you all so much for watching. Your support really means a lot to me. And until next time, bye for now. Cross my heart, making vows.